I spent a lot of time in and out of foster homes. And when I was home, it was always difficult. My mother was an alcoholic and paranoid schizophrenic, so I was dealing with a parent who had, you know, mental illness, in and out, and was in and out of a hospital. And my father was sort of in and out of the picture as well, so it was tough. I moved around at one point every 6 months to a year, sometimes more frequently. So, you know, always new schools, new environments, making friends, saying goodbye, starting all over again, over and over and over again. Separated from my sister, which often happens in foster care systems, siblings are separated. So, you know, a lot of loneliness. So yeah, it was an extremely difficult childhood. It definitely influences the subjects that I choose to write about, and just the fact that, you know, with all the reading that I did, and I lived in books, I lived in the library, and I'd read, you know, I don't know, 5-6 books at a time and go back and borrow 5 or 6 more. I was, you know, went to bed with flashlights so I could read after the lights went out. But with all of those books that I read, I rarely saw anyone in them who looked like me or who had my life experience. And I had a deep need to be validated, to know that I wasn't the only one in the world having these experiences, and I didn't find that in the literature. And so I began to feel invisible. And a lot of what I do now is I'm trying to create books for those children who, you know, like me, are in dark places in their childhood through no fault of their own, who need to be acknowledged, who need to have that acknowledged. And that affects their reading choices as well, because, you know, they'll come to my books because they find something relevant, and that makes them want to read. And I've always believed, no matter how complex language is, if you give a child a book to which he can relate, he will do whatever he needs to be able to read that book. I'd been wanting to approach the topic of grief in childhood for quite some time. It took me a while to find a publisher who didn't say, ooh, at the very idea of grief in children in the same breath. And yet children all around are suffering loss, not only the loss of a beloved pet or a grandparent, but they're losing their contemporaries in school and out of school, and as well as parents who are dying from, you know, dreadful diseases. There are all kinds of ways they're experiencing loss. And what I've noticed is that the rule of thumb seems to be, if little Johnny isn't acting out, little Johnny must be okay. And generally speaking, adults are so caught up in their own grief that they don't notice what's happening with the young people in their lives. And they're not connecting in any way. And I know that little Johnny's dying inside. You know, I lost my father when I was a little over 15, just going on 16, I guess. And it was devastating loss. And there was really no one to talk to about it. You know, you internalize these things, but they don't go away. I mean, they surface in some other sort of usually unhealthy way. And so I wanted to create a tool that would allow children who were grieving to access their feelings, to know that they were normal, and to also understand that they would pass. It's wonderful if they have the advantage of a grief counselor, but many children don't. And so I wanted to create a tool that would allow them to walk through it on their own if they had to, but that could just as well be used as a tool by psychologists and by counselors, and to be used by parents as a touchstone point to help them connect with their children, and even just to understand what their children are going through and the kinds of decisions that are critical at that time, such as giving the child you know, the right to decide whether or not to attend the funeral, and those sorts of decisions that will impact them for life. Yes, I think poetry does have a magical element to it in terms of slipping past the intellect. I think it's because our defenses are down in a way when we read poetry that they aren't when we read prose. There is surprise in poetry with the image, with that the last line, you know, that you're not looking for. And prose rarely offers the same kind of surprise. And as a result, it's touched your heart before you even knew it was coming. And there's always the, you know, there's an aha, there's a catching of the breath that happens. And I hear it all the time from audiences when I read, you know, that they're constantly caught off guard. And poetry does that. So before you've had a chance to think about it, you're weeping or you're, you know, taken back to that moment in your own childhood that you didn't even know was so close to the surface, you know. Prose, yeah, that doesn't happen very much in prose, but it happens all the time with poetry. I love travel, and I love learning new languages and learning about new cultures. And it has a huge impact not only on who I am, but on my work, maybe in an indirect way. I'm not sure how direct. But when all you see is your immediate surroundings, your immediate environment, your sense of what's possible is severely limited. And as you push out from the center of that world and explore the world beyond, your sense of what is possible for your own life grows exponentially. So as you become a citizen of the world and you move out and explore other cultures and other countries, you begin to understand that there's all this possibility that exists, you know, in the world for you as well as everyone else. And that's a great thing. And I think it's a gift to give any young person. And I hope some sense of that open possibility finds its way into my work. Children have really latched onto this character, and it's hard for them to understand that it is a character. Everywhere I go, students ask me questions like, "So when was the last time you saw Danitra?" And I say, no, Danitra's a character. "Oh, so you guys don't hang out anymore?" I mean, they really kind of don't get it. This is a character and not a real person, and they just feel that she is their best friend. Which, of course, is a wonderful thing because Meet Danitra Brown is about best friends and about this, you know, relationship. And everybody, who hasn't had a best friend? We've all had a best friend. So it's universal. And the subject matter is universal. I'm talking about teasing and secrets and just the, you know, the secret fears that we have. Everyday things that children wrestle with, they find mirrored in the stories of Danitra and her friend Zuri. I think the status of publishing is definitely better than it was 20 years ago, 30 years ago when I started, as far as African-American authors and illustrators and just books that are available for children of color to see themselves in. We still have a ways to go. One of the things that bothers me about the treatment of books by people of color, and that's African-Americans, Hispanics, Asians, is the kind of systematic marginalization of those books, which I speak to all the time when I'm addressing teachers and librarians in particular, who are in the habit of bringing out books by authors of color, you know, African Americans for, you know, the month of February, or bringing out Latino work, you know, Cinco de Mayo or Cesar Chavez Day, or, you know, slating Asian books for, you know, Chinese New Year, that sort of thing. And and nobody questions it. And also the notion of focusing on books by authors of color in schools where those students predominate, which is totally a mistake on so many levels. But one in particular is that, you know, the artist creates work with a view to showing the reader or the viewer, if it's visual art, the ways in which we are all alive beneath the skin. And so it is really critical not only to share those works with the people of the same culture, but to share those works with people of other cultures. So it's even more important that, you know, non-blacks, non-Asians, non-Latinos are reading this literature. And where is a safer place to learn about another culture than between the pages of a book? So these works need to be shared. The other thing, the other fallacy in that kind of marginalization is that the work is universal. The subject matter is universal. And how better to teach young readers that than to give them books in which they can see that for themselves, learn that for themselves, and, you know, move beyond this just perpetuation of institutional racism. And when I talk to teachers and librarians about this, what I've discovered is that very little of this is intentional. And so you can, you know, always start with the assumption that this isn't intentional. And generally it isn't. And when they're made aware of it, they stop doing it. And they say, oh, you're right, I do that, I didn't even think about it, you know. So so that's really an important message to get out. My recommendation for K through three in terms of introducing poetry is, first of all, get beyond the sense of intimidation about sharing poetry. What I've discovered is that most adults have had a really unhappy experience with poetry in their own student life. And so they're kind of put off with the very notion of sharing poetry with their students. So it's important to remember that if you present poetry as if it were castor oil, no one will like it. And a way around that is to, first of all, find poetry that you love, that you are excited about, that you get, that you're passionate about, because students are going to pick up on your attitude, first of all. And, you know, move beyond, you know, people talk about poetry that they feel should be taught. And I always say, don't should all over me. You know, choose work that you like. And the poetry market is so rich now that it can be used throughout the curriculum. There's poetry on math, on science, on, you know, space travel. I mean, poetry on just every conceivable subject, sports, school supplies, you name it. And so choose poetry that you like, that you connect with, and that you know your students are going to connect with, and start there so that they have a positive experience. And have fun with it. Don't start out by analyzing. Nobody needs to start out get them in love with the genre. You know, let analytical, you know, work come later, you know, years later. But their first experience should be enjoyable. It should be fun. Choreograph poems. Experiment with ways to perform it. Children love an opportunity to perform. You know, do reader's theater with it. You know, make it a fun experience for yourself and for your students. And after that, they'll take off. You won't be able to keep them away from it.
The Reading Rockets Meet the Author series is a production of WETA. Major funding for Reading Rockets comes from the United States Department of Education, Office of Special Education Programs. For more author interviews, recommended reading lists, and information about teaching kids to read, please visit us online at www.readingrockets.org.